text. You know, last night as I was reading this and finishing up on my notes, I realized that I have to repent about something. If I may speak in Tagalog, because I'll make a confession. Narealize ko po na parang tuwing preaching ko, humuhugot ako. Tapos lahat ng hugot ko palaging basketball. Dapat, that pinagsisihan ko po, hindi ko pala dapat ginagawa yon. Kasi hindi ko na kailangan gawin, hindi naman talaga magpapas yung mga kasama ko. Gawin ko man o hindi sila magpapas. So, yun po ang pinagsisisihan ko. Na, sorry guys, hindi ko kayo napagtiwalaan, pero now, may tiwala po ako sa inyo na tutuloy po natin. Okay, so let's go back to English. Okay, so we've already read our text, and this is our my third preaching on Genesis 24. We did one last week, we did one yesterday, and now we're going to finish up on the rest of the chapter. And we already read that, so I would like to ask everyone to please stand with me as we pray. Before we start, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning that you've given us another privilege, dear Lord, to look into your word and to be able to study it, dear Lord, meditate upon it, and be able to understand, dear Lord, the things that are written in this passage that we're studying. I pray that you continue to give me wisdom, dear Lord, and enable me, empower me as I preach. I pray that the Holy Spirit's power will be Holy Spirit will show himself mighty in our midst this morning to use the words that will be coming out of my mouth, not to be a stumbling block to anyone, but to be an encouragement, to be a challenge, dear Lord, that even if there will be some rebuke that we will be hearing, we pray, Lord, that we accept that this is from your word and that this is for our good. I pray that we will be able to glorify you and understand more on how to serve you and to bring glory to your name. And as we study, may you keep everyone attentive and do not let, dear Lord, the devil do things, dear Lord, that will remove our focus from studying your word. And as everything will be said and done, our goal, dear Lord, is to glorify you. For all these things I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for standing. You may be seated. Now, this will be the third preaching here in Genesis 24, and I'm determined to finish it today because there will be, even though there's still a long way to go, you see in the middle of the reading, we skipped a few verses because it's the servant of Abraham just rehearsing what all the things that happened, okay, and all the things that we have already studied. And during the first preaching, we learned a wonderful truth about the calling of the Lord, that all of us are called, and it's a wonderful thing to be called by God, and to, not only to be called by God, but to be able to obey the calling of God. And yesterday, we studied about God's provision that accompanies His call. Whenever God calls you, we learn that He provides, not only in one way, but in many ways. We learn that God can provide through the brethren. We learn that God will provide through our own hands when we work. And we use the strength that given to us by God to work and to provide for our needs, even though we are doing His will and full-time in the ministry. And we also learn that God provides through extraordinary means. That when people are not there, are available to help us, when somehow, like Elijah, we're not able to provide for ourselves with our own hands, God, through His way, through His own amazing ways, will provide for us anyway. We should not restrict on how the Lord provides. He provides anyway. Even if people will hoard resources given to them by God that is meant to be a blessing to people that are called by God, God will provide anyway. And He does that because we are faithfully obeying His will, faithfully obeying His call in our lives. We saw that when we are unsure yesterday of what to do, and there will be a lot of times that we will be unsure about what to do in the ministry while we're doing the will of God, it's not time to resort to worldly wisdom. It is the time to get on our knees, pray to the Lord, and ask for wisdom whenever we're unsure. And it is foolish to do the will of God, the ministry of God, and use worldly wisdom in the process. This is the reasoning comes from when we hear to from other pastors. You know, if the mayor has this, the pastor should have that. If the Iglesia ni Cristo are doing this, the Baptist should do that as well. right? This is worldly reasoning, worldly wisdom. And they're comparing the ministry of God to what the world is doing, the system of this world. And we can never apply the system of this world in the economy of God. It works completely differently. It works in ways that the world will never understand. There's a reason why believers or people who obey the will of God look foolish in this world. They will never agree with what you're doing. And that's why if they agree with you, with what you're doing, the world agrees and you agree with the world, then there's something wrong with you. It's the other way around. The world has pulled you into their system and you have not been living above that the world system. We have learned that. So whenever we are faced with difficulty and times that we're unsure of what to do, it's time for us to get on our knees, ask wisdom that is coming from God. And then we can go through that hurdle. And if we do that, we can easily bring glory to the name of the Lord. Why? Because we did it. We did what God wants us to do, and we did it the way He wants us to do it, not in the way that we want to do it. And and yesterday we learned that the main reason why we have to get on our knees and pray is because, of course, it's God's command for us to pray, but also that He answers prayer. We learned that yesterday, that He does answer prayer. And there's no reason for us not to trust Him in prayer and to depend on Him, because He has proven again and again, over and over again, that He is faithful and that He will provide for our needs and He will answer our prayers according to His will. So we saw that with the Lord's call, not only does provision come with it, but guidance as well. The Lord will not leave us blind. Now, we saw that in the life of the saints in the Bible, especially in the life of the Apostle Paul. Each step of the way, the Lord directs him. Now, if you're willing, and we saw yesterday in the verse that because the servant was in the way, the Lord guided him. Now, the Lord guides you as you continue to follow and continue to follow Him, stepping in faith, stepping in obedience. This morning, we learned in our Bible class in Matthew that the life of a Christian is characterized in obedience. Now, when we obey the Lord's call for salvation, to repent of our sins and place our faith in Christ, it didn't stop there. Our life will be characterized by obedience after obedience after obedience. And Christ said in Matthew 7 that if you hear the word of God and you obey, you're wise. But if you hear the word of God and you disobey, you're a fool. You're even, especially if you're a believer, you already have proven the existence of God, you already have proven the word of God to be true, and yet still not trust it, and yet disobey it, you're more of a fool than people who don't believe in God at all. Right? That's why Christ said, if you already have the right foundation, you are saved, you have been in Christ, build upon it the right way in obeying the Lord. So this morning, as we end our messages here in Genesis 24, we're going to look at three people. Well, mainly four, but the other two connected with each other. First is Laban, and then again we're going to revisit the servant, though we have already been talking about him for the past two messages. And then we'll talk about Rebekah and Isaac. So first, let's go to Laban. Here in verse number 28, we read a while ago, but let's read it again. The Bible says, "And the damsel ran and told them of her mother's house these things." So we know what happened. The servant arrived into the place where Abraham told him to go. He didn't know what to do. He prayed to the Lord. And then the Lord guided him to meet Rebekah. And then all of the things he prayed about, the Lord answered. And he was sure that it's this girl, this woman, would be the one that the Lord is the one that the Lord chose for Isaac. So what happened here now is Rebekah ran, went to the house because the servant asked her, "Is there room in your house for me to stay? And I want to meet your family." So now Rebekah ran there and told them what happened, everything that happened. And remember that when Rebekah ran there, she's already wearing some of the treasure that the servant gave her. So what happened there was Rebekah had a brother, and his name was Laban. And what did Laban do after hearing these things, hearing the treasure? And Laban ran out unto the man, unto the well. I'm sure Rebekah didn't leave out the part that this servant is wealthy. A servant of a wealthy person. And he had much treasure with him and men with him. And we can know that by the response of Laban. Because he ran out and met with the guy. Because of the treasure. Because of the things that he had heard. And one, you might ask me today and say, "Hey, you're being a little bit judgmental here. Maybe Laban is just hospitable. And he wants to welcome the servant." But that's the beauty of the Bible. If you read the Bible, you know the Bible, you can make righteous judgment. And we know in the future, and if you continue reading Genesis, in the later chapters, we know what kind of man Laban really is. He's a man who manipulates people to get what he wants. He's a man who makes deals that is usually in his favor. You know, he used Jacob. He used his daughters for Jacob to get his services for 14 years and using his very own daughters. That's why right there I can judge that Laban ran because of the treasure. Laban ran out because of the wonderful thing that he has heard, and he knows that he can profit from this. So after hearing that, he ran to outside, and then saw the servant and saw all of these things. And then we saw here that what do you call this? In the ministry, when we do the work of God, especially here in Cambodia, and this is not. I'm not saying this because people in Cambodia are generally. I'm not saying anything bad against them, but generally in the ministry, whether you're in Cambodia, in America, or in the Philippines, you're going to meet people like Laban. You're going to meet people who are there, and when they hear the gospel, when they see the Bible, when they see the missionary, all they think, all they see is a way out of poverty. Or all they see is a way to make money. And we know that. We've seen that with a lot of preachers, a lot of people using the ministry in order to enrich themselves. And if you haven't noticed, they're using the Bible to do that. They're using the very word of God to do that. They give examples like the widow and Elijah. They say that the widow gave to the man of God all that she had left, and God bless her. So give me all that you have, and God will bless you. Then in return, they become rich in the ministry. Now, it's true that God, anyone can use the Bible to enrich themselves. We've seen that with many false teachers, with many prosperity gospel preachers in America. There's so many rich people, they become rich televangelists using the Bible. And not only that, but even the poor can see the gospel as a way out of poverty. That's why we have to be careful and to be wise. Do not use money to attract people to the Lord. Amen. Do not use treasure to attract people to the Lord. Because though God will guide us to the right people, the devil will always send greedy people on our way. We have to still reach them with the gospel, and God can change them, definitely. But we must be wise not to trust them completely. We have to have that discernment. Because even though the servant here will not be affected much with Laban, but someday we will see that that Jacob will realize what kind of man this guy really is. And this guy will use anything in order to enrich himself, in order for himself to have gain. And we should be wise. We're going to meet people like that. And I'm not saying that here in the ministry in Cambodia, we don't help people. That's what we do. We go to the villages, we teach free English, we give them things that they need, because they need help. And we are blessed by God, and we can help them, but we should be careful to balance things out, not to attract them with these things. Why? Because it will be that much harder for them to understand the gospel. It will be that much harder for them to say that we are bringing Christ and the gospel, and we're not giving you just a way out of poverty. Because God might, God may bless them and give them a way out of poverty, but God may not as well. And we should not give this as their motivation. I don't know if any one of us here is in the ministry because of that. I don't know if anyone of us here is in the ministry because of money. But if that is your motivation, then you're in the wrong place. You're in the wrong ministry. You are doing the wrong thing. Why? God will not bless you if you have that kind of thinking. Now, we have to be wise. That's why in the village, what I'm doing is I seldom give away a lot of things. Why? Because we have noticed that, right? When it's Christmas, Khmer New Year, yeah, when during the time that we give away give out gifts, and we love doing that because we see people are having joy in those kinds of things, and that's completely okay. But the attendance will be cut in half after that, right? And we don't blame them. We're not blaming them because that is something that gives them joy. But we must be wise in balancing things out. Now, we have homeboys here from the village that I go to, especially Panlu has surrendered his life full-time in the ministry. I praise the Lord that he understands it's not about the money. Because if it's just about the money, then he could do something else so that he can earn more money. But it's not about the money. And be careful not to attract people with money. And the reason why I'm warning saying this warning is because many people use money in the ministry to attract. Many people do that. Not only money, but things or basic needs of people. Come, we'll give you rice. Come, we'll give you clothes. Come and do this, come and do that. Just for them to take a snap, a photo, send it to the supporters in order to enrich themselves. Right? Never make money or riches or material things as your motivation in service. Okay? Just like this guy. But though this servant is not really concerned about what kind of guy Laban is, all he's concerned about is getting Rebekah back to his place to get married to Isaac. But in some way, somehow, we will see here that Laban still tempted him, like the preaching this morning, to just rest a little bit, just to forget about his mission, just for a week or for 10 days, just relax and enjoy the pleasures that we can give you, and then you can get back and then do the will of God again. The devil used Laban to tempt this servant that way, but we will go there later. Okay, we see here that there are really people in the ministry that are just here to use the ministry. In the history of this church, if you've been here for 15, 20 years with us here in this church, we've seen people come and go who use the ministry, right? We see brother the white guy who looks like a Korean who's preaching for us, and then he went away during a Sunday. I forgot his name, but he left because a Korean church offered him more money. We see Pastor Lito and his family. They just used the ministry for themselves. We see a lot of people who came and go using the ministry for themselves. That's why we are being strict in accepting membership today. Because even the disciples of Christ, the apostles themselves, were fooled by this kind of person. Remember Judas? Nobody expected him to be the betrayer of Christ. Let's look at Matthew chapter 26, verse 21 to 25. The Bible says, "And as they did eat, he said, Verily I say unto you," this is Christ talking, "that one of you shall betray me. And they were exceeding sorrowful, and began every one of them to say unto him, Ask him, Lord, is it me? Is it I? And he answered and said, He that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. The Son of Man goeth as it was written of him, but woe unto that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been good for that man if he had not been born. Then Judas, which betrayed him, answered and said, Master, is it I? He said, And to him thou hast said." Now, for the sake of time, we're not going through the whole gospel to see the complete account of this last supper and God's Christ's prediction of who is going to betray him. But we see here first in this account in Matthew 26 that Judas waited for everyone else to ask, "Is it I? Is it I? Is it I?" And their words were, "Lord, is it I?" And after that, Judas asked, "Master, is it I?" Now we see here, just by that, you might think that the apostles will have their suspicion. Everyone called him Lord except Judas. He said, "Master," or "Teacher, is it I?" Right? And in other accounts, we see in the book of John that Christ said, "Whoever I will give this bread to, that's going to be him." So Christ gave the bread to who? Judas. And here, if we're going to combine all of the accounts, the actual scene is like this. Christ said, "Whoever will dip his hand with me here will be the person who will betray me." So it's Christ and then Judas. Judas dipped his hand there and said, "Is it I?" And everyone saw that. Everyone saw that it was Christ handed the bread to him. But after that, Christ said, "Go, Judas, and do what you're about to do." Nobody even suspected for him to be the one to betray Christ. They even thought that, oh, he might be buying something else to help the people, because it was a feast during that day. That is how deceptive he was. And if we are not going to exercise discernment in the ministry, we're going to meet a lot of Judas along the way that will make the ministry that much harder for us. That's why we have to exercise discernment with this kind of people. I'm not saying that to stay away from them, win them to Christ, present the gospel to them, but don't be so foolish to trust this kind of people, and because the devil is using them to slow down the ministry, and we're going to see that later. What did the Bible say in our text here, verse 30? "And it came to pass when he saw the earring and bracelet upon his sister's hand, And when he heard the words of Rebekah, saying, Thus spake the man unto me, that he came unto the man, and behold, he stood by the camels at the well. And what did he say to the servant? Come in, thou blessed of the Lord. Wherefore standest thou without? For I have prepared the house and the room for camels. The reason why it's hard to discern this kind of people is they say the right words. They say the words that you want to hear. Ah, bakit ka nandiyan sa labas? Mainit dyan. Pasok ka dito. Pinipray ko na yung pagkain mo. Diba? You, especially if you're a person who likes to be flattered, it's easy for you to be fooled by them. Right? So these people say the right words. They will never enter a church. And if their motivation is wrong, they will never enter a church and say all the wrong words. It's easy to detect them then. But these people that the devil plants inside our ministry are people who says the correct word. How many times have we had workers here who say, I want to serve the Lord, I want to give my life to the Lord, I want to give all to the Lord, He saved me, blah, 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 all of these things. Where are they now? Right? They're outside doing something else. We have never seen them come back to this church at all. Not one of them came even on a Sunday just to worship with us. But then there was a time where they were claiming that I will give my life to the Lord. That I will serve the Lord. We all have. I will forsake everything and give it to the Lord. But then just money came. All of these offers came and they're gone. As soon as that came, they're gone. We never saw them again. That's why we have to be careful with people who always flatter you. People who flatter you. The Bible says in Proverbs 26, 24 to 26, He that hateth dissembleth with his lips, and layeth up deceit within him. When he speaketh fair, believe him not. For there are seven abominations in his heart, whose hatred is covered by deceit. His wickedness shall be shewed before the whole congregation. Proverbs 29:5, A man that flattereth his neighbor spreadeth a net for his feet. It's very dangerous, this kind of people, who has nothing bad to say to you. Nothing bad at all. It's like you're the most perfect person in the world. It's like you're the best person in the world. All they have to say to you are good things. Galing mo talaga. Ano mo, ngayon lang ako nakarinig ng ganyang klaseng preaching. Ibang klase, touch po talaga ako, pastor. Sana po, lagi po kayo naririnig mag-preach. Na, ano po talaga. Yeah, ganda ng boses mo. Galing ng awit. Sana ikaw uli kumanta next week. Pag ikaw kumakanta, natatouch talaga ako. Now, this kind of people are very dangerous. All they have to say are good things. And all they have to say are people who are things that will puff you up. And if you are a person who loves to be flattered, you're an easy prey. You're an easy prey. Because their victims are people who loves flattery. Ha, ito, talaga, biyaya lang ng Panginoon yung preaching na yan. Blessing lang ng Panginoon yung boses na yan. Ginagamit ko lang para sa kanya. Pero pumapalakpak naman yung tenga mo. Kung gusto mo, if you like to be flattered, you're an easy prey. Tapos ka, yari ka. That's why as believers, we should not look for flattery all the time. The flattery should make you, nahirapan din tuloy. Para nga, sabi nga ni Mon, maintindihan nyo na hindi magaling mag-English. Dapat medyo kikilabutan kayo. Pag pinipraise kayo ng pinipraise. I don't know that in English. It's like you should not feel good about flattery. You should thank Him, say praise the Lord for that. But if someone just keeps on flattering you, you should not feel easy about that. You should not be comfortable. Why? Because there's nothing good in you. You know that. Even if you sang a great song, even if you preached a great message, and after that people praise you for that, it should not make you feel comfortable. You're going to be an easy prey to with this kind of people. And Proverbs is full of warnings against these people. And interestingly enough, the Bible tells us, as men, talking to the men, to stay away from this kind of women. What did the Bible say in Proverbs 7:5? That they may keep thee from strange women. If you read the whole book of whole chapter 7, you see what kind of woman this is. But one of the characteristics is from the stranger which flattereth with her words. Gwapo mo talaga. Ikaw na talagang binigay ng Panginoon para sa akin. You're God's blessing to me. You're so handsome. Your voice is so nice and all of these things. And then they do that to get your heart to love them, right? And you might say that, you're being too much, brother. But there are women who are like that. And if you go to the Philippines and you compare women of a few generations back to women now, it's the women who are going out of their way to get men for themselves. And they use flattery words. That's why, you know, I've had, you know, just a handful of relationships in the past. Konti lang. But one thing unique about my wife is she never flatters me. Never flatters me. I've never heard her say that I'm handsome, even though I know that. Never, she never says that. Never flatters me. And even now that she's already married me, she has no more choice, right? Because she already married me. She still doesn't flatter me at all. And even though sometimes I want to hear just a little bit of flattery, just you give self-confidence, boost your confidence. You know, wives, you should do that sometimes. Even though your husbands, you know, have a big tummy already, tell them that you're still okay. Why? If they lose their confidence, kayo rin ang mahirapan. Yeah? But she never does. Never flatters me. Sometimes I even ask for it. But I appreciate that. You know, I appreciate that she never flatters me. And I do appreciate it in one way, but a little flattery will do as well. Not only during our anniversary and my birthday. Because she only flatters me during my birthday. It's her gift to me. But I appreciate that. Why? She never flatters me. Because a person who just keeps flattering you will not be of help to you. Not be of help to you. If you want to have good friends and people partner in the ministry, look for people who are honest. And better, brutally honest with you. Will tell you your mistake to your face. Will tell you what you're doing wrong to your face. People who flatter you will just as easily stab you in the back. But people who are honest with you, they're honest, they tell you what to do, what you are, and they tell you things for what they really are people who should treasure in the ministry as partners. Proverbs 28:23 says, he that rebuketh a man afterwards shall find more favor than he that flattereth with his tongue. Proverbs 27:6, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful. And in the ministry, you meet people who keeps on flattering you. It's better to stay away from those people, but be close to people who are honest with you, who will tell you things to your face. And stay away from people like Laban, who will just use you. And as soon as they're done using you, they will say all the bad things you're going to hear in your life. We've had our fair share of that. And the Lord let us experience that for us to be wiser now. Right? And we should not make the same mistakes. Now, people who are here thinking they are with us, and then once they're done with the church, they leave. And they don't just leave. They destroy the testimony of the church everywhere they go. Why? This is the kind of people they are. People like Laban. And don't tell me that when you're in the ministry, you're going to meet all the angels in the world. That is not true. When I entered Bible seminary, I thought that everyone in that dormitory are angels. But these are men of God who surrendered their lives to God. This, I will learn so much from them. But I did learn so much from them to stay away from those kind of people. There are a lot of devils inside the dormitory in seminary as well. That is the place where I saw people who will get your toothbrush, use your toothbrush to clean the toilet, put it back there, and let you use it to brush your teeth. That is, those are the kind of people, that's where I saw people who would literally kill you. Right, they were fighting, I woke up, I saw a guy strangling our friend. He doesn't want to let go. I don't know why they're fighting, but he was strangling them. And we had to pull them apart because he was ready to kill the man. That's where I saw that kind. And the devil will plant these people so that to distract you from your mission. Just like Laban. And we see here in verse number 55, to skip to that, what did Laban tempt the servant with? And her brother and her mother said, let the damsel abide with us for a few days. At least just 10 days, right? After that, she shall go. And this is a very reasonable thing, right? You're taking my sister, you're taking my sister away for good. Please let us just stay with her just for 10 days. But what did the servant say? Please don't delay my mission. Let us leave now, which is the cue for us to go to the servant. Now, we have been comparing the servant to ourselves, right? As servants of the Lord, ministers of the Lord, and preaching the gospel here. But what can we learn from the servant's responses here to Laban? First point I want to make about the servant under this is we have to waste no time in service and prioritize our ministry. Waste no time in service and prioritize our ministry. Look at verse 32 and 33. And the man came into the house, and he girded his camels, and gave straw and provender for the camels, and water to wash his feet, and the man's feet that were with him, all good. Verse 33, and there was set meat before him, may pagkain, and of his baptism, He's going to eat immediately, but he's not, I'm sure. But he said, I will not eat until I have told mine errand. And he said, speak on. It's perfectly understandable if the servant will say, let me eat first before I tell you why I'm here. Why? Because he had a long journey. All he had was water from Rebecca. Now he's there. There's food on the table. He can smell the food. He can see the rice. He can see the chicken, all this thing. And it's perfectly okay for him to eat. But he said, not until I tell you why I'm here. Now, while I was studying last night, I remembered our preacher's meeting every Tuesday. Now, there are Tuesdays that we have a lot of food before we do our meeting. And this is courtesy of Cedric's team most of the time. They're the ones who prepare most of the time. Not all the time, but most. Maybe 90%. They prepare the food. But what I notice is if we feast before we meet, we find ourselves at the end of the night not being able to do anything. Napakain na, napakwento na, napasarap ang kape. Hindi natapos yung meeting. Diba? No, just being honest. Because sometimes, yun yung temptation eh. Just like this guy, mapakain siya, ay malasing, tapos, hindi na niya nasabi. That's why he said, I will not eat until I tell you why I'm here. And if you compare that to ourselves, what we are here, why are we here in Cambodia? We're here to preach the gospel, to send the message, and to reach as many people as possible with the gospel message. And the devil will tempt us to rest a bit. Delay it a little bit. Enjoy life. Enjoy these pleasures of this world. Do this, do that. And that's the preaching this morning. That is us, the devil tempting us not to be faithful to our calling. I'm not saying do not enjoy your life. There's a time for that. And God gives you time to enjoy. But there are times in our lives that it's not time to enjoy. It's time to grind. It's time to do our mission. It's time to proclaim the gospel message to people. And that should be the priority. Do not waste time. Do not waste time. The world will entangle us with the things of this world, with the pleasure, with things that we can enjoy. But if we let ourselves be entangled in that, then we will find ourselves useless in the ministry of God. Right? Prioritize. Know your priority. When the Lord has something for you to do and you're being tempted to delay and to rest up a bit, we have to just, parabang, pag isang tabi mo muna yung rest, tapusin mo muna yung ginagawa. I remember when I was in the seminary, when we were being enslaved with construction work, there's this preacher, his name is Sir Dennis Cunanan, and he always tells us, while you're doing all these things, carrying a lot of things, you're tired, he always tells us in Tagalog, tuloy lang, tapusin nyo yan, pagod lang yan, tulog lang ang katapat niyan. Yan yung sinasabi, which is true, right? There's a time for rest, and it's rest will be better if you know that you have done what you did, or you are supposed to do, right? But if you rest, and you know that when you wake up, there's still a lot of work, parang ang hirap magpahinga. Pero mas masarap magpahinga kung alam mo, natapos mo yung gawain mo. Right? I'm not saying never rest. There's time for us to rest. But you will know, God will give you wisdom when it's that time and when it's time to fulfill your mission. Now I say this as well to the institute students. Some of you here are studying three subjects every week, Sunday and then Monday and then Wednesday. And sometimes, 3 weeks, puro exam ang mangyayari dyan. It's very easy for you to say, ayoko na, kapagod. Right? But if that is your commitment to God, you have to give your best to that. And for those of you who have asked me as a teacher, you should have learned by now. The more you complain, the harder I make it. So, never complain. just smile and nod. And then I'll make it easier, right? But if you, reklamo kayo ha? Oh, dagdagan natin yung tanong. Ah, reklamo, dagdagan natin yung homework. Diba? Kaya, wag na kayong magreklamo. Gawin nyo pa lang yung inyong commitment sa Panginoon. You know, the Lord will provide rest. When it's not time to rest, do not rest. Keep on working in the ministry. Now let's again compare it to our job here. It's the message, the gospel message. Right? We go to outreaches, we preach, we do all of these things. But the main thing we're bringing to them is the gospel message. And prioritize that. Prioritize that above all. If you go to outreach, you only have an hour to spend. Unahin natin yung preaching, the gospel message. Hindi na tayo makapagturo English, that's better. But make sure that we have preached the gospel to them. Because you, who knows, that might be the last time we meet them. That might be the last time we see them. And we have to keep on preaching the gospel message. And verse 49, and if look at again the priority of the servant. And now, if you, after he ate and all these things. Because God gives a place for that. After he said all of these things, He ate. And then natulog din naman siya. Pero tinapos niya muna yung gawain niya. And then the next day, he said in verse 49, and now if you will, after the message, and now if you will deal kindly and truly with my master, tell me, and if not, tell me that I may not, that I may turn to the right, that I may turn to the right hand or to the left. In other words, do you agree? If not, tell me now so we will not waste our time. So that I will know if you're not the one, I will look for others. I will carry on my mission. But until and unless I'm sure that you agree and Rebecca is the one, I will not eat, I will not rest. Right? That is the kind of priority he's giving to the mission. And that is something that we also need to apply. Prioritize our ministry. Prioritize our ministry. Whether that ministry is your family, whether that ministry is something in the church, prioritize that over the things of this world. Not only that, but we can see also in this servant, proclaim the whole gospel and only the gospel. In verse number 34 to 48, if you will read that, do it in, at home. He said every little detail. From Abraham giving him the command to his ordeal with Rebecca at the well until he came to this house. Sinabi niya lahat. The message that he was supposed to bring, he faithfully brought it to Laban and to the family of Rebecca. Now, transition that to our time. What our job is to proclaim the gospel, period. To proclaim the whole gospel, do not remove anything from it, do not add anything. Right? What's happening today? You hit a hurdle in the ministry, people are not responding to the gospel, what will you do? Let's remove some things in the gospel that are hard to swallow. Right? Just preach about heaven. Yeah. You want to go to heaven? Everyone wants to go to heaven? Me, let's pray, and you'll go to heaven. That is easier. Right? Let's remove the hard to swallow part. Let's teach them that when we already got their heart, when they trust us. Now, people do that, and that is not our job. That is not our job. Our job is to keep on doing that. But sometimes we just say, instead of proclaiming the whole gospel, we tempt them with heaven or we scare them of hell. You know what is hell? Hell is this, hell is that. You know you don't want to go there. Nobody in their right mind wants to go there. Do you want to go to hell? See, nobody wants to go to hell. If you don't want to go to hell, repeat this prayer. You're saved. You're going to heaven. Right? They're polluting the gospel that we have to preach. And the reason why they do that, simply the root of this is this. The root reasoning is this. They don't trust that the gospel that God gave us is enough to save people. They think that it's too harsh, Lord. It's not going to work in Cambodia. It's too harsh. If you tell them to turn their back from the idols, they're not going to do that. It's too harsh. Maybe leave that out first. Right? Or maybe we'll say, Lord, it's too easy. Or Lord, it's too boring. The message of the gospel is too boring. I don't want to read that. I want to add some choreography. I want to add something else. And then when I got their attention, then I'll preach the gospel. A shallow version of the gospel. That is what they're doing. And this servant, remember, he already told Rebecca everything. And then after a while, he has to tell this guy everything again. But he's faithful to say the things that he had to say. He didn't leave out any detail. He said everything. That is our job, to proclaim the whole gospel and not to remove anything and not to add anything to it. And if we do that, it's going to work. It's going to work. It's going to produce results. Verse 50 to 52. And Laban and Bethuel answered and said, after hearing all of these things, the thing that proceeded from the Lord, we cannot speak unto thee bad or good. Why? Because if the gospel is proclaimed, the power of the gospel is going to work. Behold, Rebekah is before thee. Take her and go and let her be my master's son's wife as the Lord had spoken. Even Laban, a very greedy person, recognized that this is from the Lord. Why? Because it was faithfully preached. It was faithfully relayed. Nothing was left out of it. Kaya nga po tayo, just preach the gospel. Do not worry about how people will respond. That is the problem of the Holy Spirit. That is the problem of God. Just faithfully preach the gospel. And it is the power of God unto salvation. Not your gimmicks. Not your the things that you want to do. Not your own thinking. The power of God to salvation is the gospel and nothing else. Nothing else. That's why we just have to preach it. Verse number 52. And it came to pass that when Abraham's servant heard the words, successful, sabi niya, success, tapos ang mission ko. He worshiped the Lord, bowing himself to the earth. If you faithfully preach the gospel, you don't remove anything from it, You don't add anything to it, you will have no reason to praise yourself, but only the Lord. Why? Because if you had all this program, getting people in here, giving them what they need, showing them what they want to see, but you will be tempted to say, ah, I'm wise. No, I added to this, I helped the Lord save these people. You know, if not for my idea, the Lord will never be able to save these people. If we didn't dance this routine, I think they will not listen to the Bible. If we didn't give them free this, free that, they will not listen to the gospel. Now, it will give you an opportunity or tempt you to praise yourself instead of the Lord. And the Lord has nothing to do with all these gimmicks and the false profession you just had. The Lord has nothing to do with that. The Lord will only be glorified and praised if you preached faithfully the gospel and the Holy Spirit did the saving and not you. Now, not only that, we can see also here in the servant, not to lose focus. Don't lose focus. Verse 55 and 56, the Bible says, "And her brother and her mother said, let the damsel stay with us a few days, at least 10. After that she shall go. What did the servant say? And he said unto them, hinder me not. Seeing the Lord had prospered my way, send me away that I may go to my master." All they were asking is 10 days. It's easy to say, okay. I remember yesterday, it was a very awkward situation at the outreach because Ponlu's brother came, his older brother, and he is convincing Ponlu to go back to studying Khmer. Now, his approach is this. Ponlu, I heard that you have been feeling headaches like for the past few days. Why don't you come home just for a week and let us take care of you? Why is it enough? Ponlu said, no, I will not go, not even a day. Because he knows that that week will be them convincing him to change his decision. Right? So he said, no, I will stay there. Don't worry, they're taking care of me. They will not let me die. Right? I don't know, are you guys going to let him die here? I'm sure you'll not let him die. Right? And I will be there. I'm not even laboring hard. I'm just studying at night. Right? He has a lot of time to sleep and to rest. And he knows that. And I praise the Lord that he realized that. You know, I have been, I don't know about you, but this is a great blessing. Nagkaroon po tayo ng bunga. Na, I don't know, we only time will tell. But as of sa ngayon, yung mga pinapakita niya at yung kanyang resolve is something that is should be a great blessing to us. That the Lord will really call people. And he realized that even, what is 1 week to stay with your family? It's even a chance to share the gospel to them. But you know that's the devil's ruse. And you're wise enough to say no. Say no to them. And no, I will not go. But I told him, when the time comes that you're ready, you can go. Share to them the gospel, and they will not be able to change change your mind. But then this guy said, oh, just stay here for 10 more days. Enjoy. The food was nice last night, right? You can have more for 10 more days. Now, it has been preached this morning, no man that entangleth himself with the world will be useful in the ministry. What did the Bible said in 2 Timothy 2, 3, and 4? Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. If you concern yourself a lot with pleasures in this world, with things that you can enjoy, you will not be useful in the ministry. Lagi ka madidistract. You always go to a detour. You always go out of your way, out of the will of God, and then come back after you have thoroughly enjoyed the world. That is not the will of the Lord. And this servant knows that. Now, I will not stay here even for another minute. Let me go. Let me take Rebecca to my master. The Lord already answered my prayer. This is my mission. I will not lose focus. I will keep on doing my mission. I will not be sidetracked by the pleasures of this world. I will not be sidetracked by all of these things. I will continue doing the ministry of the Lord. The word entangled, it means to involve yourself or to be intertwined with. Parang yung tinirintas. Nabuhul ka na. No, if you enjoy the system of this world, the world will bury you deep into its system, will render you useless in the ministry. Right? That's why the Bible says, if any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, we know what is all in this, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And if you get buried deep into that, ang hirap nang umalis. That's why you should not lose focus while you're doing that. 1 Corinthians and I'd like to make this point, and we have been discussing this last week as well, that even your marriage and family can, even though it's a blessing from God, and it has been, the point has been made this morning, even though it's a blessing from God, can be something or can be a curse if you don't know how to use them properly. First Corinthians 7, 32-35. But I would have you without carefulness. Paul is talking to these people. He that is unmarried careth for the things that belong to the Lord. Now he may how he may please the Lord. But he that is married careth for the things that are of the world, how he may please his wife. There is difference also between a wife and a virgin. The unmarried woman careth for the things of the Lord, that she may be holy both in body and spirit. But he that is married careth for the things of the world, how she may please her husband. And this I speak for your own profit, not that I may cast a snare upon you, but for that which is comely, that ye may attend upon the Lord without distraction. Now, Paul is not telling you not to get married. And Paul is not saying, but he's making a good point here. Because he's not telling you not to get married, because at the beginning of this chapter, he basically prescribed everyone to get married. If you have desire towards the opposite sex, get married. That's what Paul said. But if you're single, use that opportunity to focus on the Lord and your service to Him. Why? Because if you get married, you can easily lose focus and just focus on your wife. Lose focus, just focus on your husband, or focus with your kids, and then stray away from the will of God, which is very much possible. Napaka-possible po niya. Very easy to do, actually. Very easy for that to happen to you. And those who are married knows what I'm saying. Right? If it comes to choosing between the ministry and your family, it's a no-brainer. You always choose your family. But if we don't know how to handle it well, we're going to be far away from the Lord. That's why this can be a curse as well. If we don't know, if you use your family as an excuse not to fulfill your ministry to the Lord, then you are using it wrongly. The blessing of the Lord has become a curse in your life. I'm not saying do not love your family. You love your family. Do everything that you have to do. The Bible says you love your wife to a point that you're willing to give your life for your wife. But we have to realize that God is higher than our family. And that is something, do not lose focus. Now, going to Rebecca, what time is it? Still have time. You know, if our pastor preach, he can preach until 1. So I can do that. Rebecca, now while we praise the servant for being obedient and all these things, we've talked about the servant for 3 preachings. Multiply that in the obedience of Rebecca. Why? Because she is the person here who had more to lose. She is the person in this story who is risking more than the servant. Right? If the servant fails, what did Abraham say? If you did your best and nothing happened, you're free. Right? I'm not going to blame you. But Rebecca here is willing to leave her family, leave her comfort, leave the things that she got used to, go to a place she hasn't been to, get married to a guy she hasn't seen. Right? But knowing that this thing is from the Lord. And Rebecca is a woman of God. Why? We see that in her attitude, in her custom, in her tradition that she's honoring. She's a woman of God. Knowing that this is the will of God, she is more than willing and ready to obey. What happened in verse 56 and 57? And it said unto them, the servant said, hinder me not, let me go. Verse 57, Laban answered, and they said, we will call the damsel and inquire at her mouth. Right? This again shows us the sovereignty of God and the responsibility of man. Because all of these things that happened can crumble if Rebecca will say, oh, no, I don't want. Ang dami niyo pang sinabi, nag-negotiate pa kayo, ayoko naman. Diba? Nag-usap na sila, kinuha na yung treasure, ganito yung gagawin natin, sige, tanong natin si Rebecca, ba't niyo ako tinatanong, sino ba nagsabing sasama ako sa mga yan? What if Rebecca replied, I don't want to go. Whatever you talked about with Laban, you and my mom, I don't want to go. If Rebecca said that, everything's gone. Everything's finished. That's why the responsibility of man is still there. The Lord has made the will, His will, clear. He has shown you the way, but it's up to you. Are you going to obey or not? What did Rebecca say in verse 58? And they called Rebecca, okay, and said, what did she say? Will thou go with this man? And she said, I will go. I will go. Put yourself in her position. Are you going to say you will go? Right? A lot of uncertainties. And this is much like Abraham. When God called Abraham to go to a place that I will not tell you, just keep going, he went anyway. And Rebecca is doing the same thing. Go to a place where you haven't been, marry a man whom you haven't seen, this is my will for you, just go. And she said yes. This is the kind of obedience of faith and trust we need to have with the Lord. If it's clear that it is His will, there might be a lot of uncertainties along the way, but go anyway. There might be a lot of questions in your mind, and maybe they were not answered during this time, but obey anyway. Follow the will of God anyway. Go anyway. The Bible is full of men and women forsaking themselves in order to obey the Lord. When the Lord called the apostles while they were fishing, immediately they left their nets and followed Him. And called another one, immediately they left their boats and even the servants of their fathers and followed Christ immediately. And this is something that is maybe harder for some of us to do, to let go of our way of living and follow the Lord. To let go of our job and follow the Lord. If it comes to that, can you say yes? If it comes to God saying, let go of what your job that is supplying for your need and your family and obey me, go to a place where I will tell you someday, are you going to say yes? And maybe it will not come to that position, but if it does come to that, will you have enough faith like Rebecca to say, yes, I will go, Lord. Yes, I will go. I trust you. You will replace it with something better. Maybe you will not replace it with more money, but you will replace it with a blessing in following your will. Can you say yes to that? Are you in that kind of place in your faith right now who you can say that you can say yes to the Lord no matter what happens? Now, for me, I have it easy. My family is not stopping me from serving the Lord. No one is. I don't think my father will someday say, don't be a pastor or stop preaching. He will not say that. And that is a blessing that me and Preacher Mon, Preacher June has, because we have our fathers to be pastors, and they just encourage us, push us, do the will of God. But it's different when it's your family saying no. I just compare that to Ponlu. He has surrendered his life just for a few weeks, and family after family will come and try to change his mind. I can't imagine what I'm going to do if that happens. What if my wife say, can you just stop preaching, please, and just focus more on your job so we can be rich someday? I might have a theory in my mind of how to answer her, but when I'm in that position, I don't know. Now, ask yourself that. What if that happens to you? What if God asks you to forsake everything and follow Him? What would happen to those people who decided to follow the Lord in Matthew chapter 4? They decided to follow the Lord and said, Lord, can you just please let me bury my father first? Now, the Lord didn't say, no, don't attend your father's funeral. He didn't say that. What He really meant was, let me take care of my father until he die, and then I will follow you. But the Lord said, don't delay. If you do not want to turn your back from that, you're not worthy of me. The other said, let me say goodbye to my family first. Maybe for us, we want to follow the Lord, but we don't want to let go of a lot of things. Lord, I'll follow you, but please don't remove this from my life. Lord, I follow you, but please let me do this at the same time. That is not what obedience is. At the beginning of this, the first message I preach here, the Lord blesses whole obedience. Not delayed obedience, not obedience that you only choose what you want to obey. The Lord will bless full obedience. You follow Him no matter what you have to let go. You follow Him no matter what you have to lose, because that's what He wants. That is His will for you. Even if that it means you have to turn your back from your family, God will bless you. Trust that He will bless you, and He has His will for you, and keep on following Him. Verse number 60, what happened to Rebecca? Then they blessed Rebecca and said unto her, thou art our sister. Be thou the mother of thousands of millions, and let thy seed possess the gate of those which hate them. Though we should not make blessing as our motivation to follow, but we cannot deny the fact that obedience will have blessing. Always have blessing. What is the blessing that Rebecca was able to be part of the great plan of God? Imagine the sovereign God who created the world, who can see from eternity to eternity and has a plan for mankind, chose you to be part of that. You to be part of it. Me to be part of that plan. His plan for eternity, His choosing me to, hey, I want you to be part of it. I want you to preach for me. I want you to sing for me. I want you to do this for me. That is a great blessing. Think about that for a moment. You being a part of God's eternal plan. What a great blessing. And we have the audacity to say, no, Lord, I want pleasure. No, Lord, I want money. No, Lord, I want family. No, that is ridiculous. If you just look at it, maybe, of course we cannot do that, but try to think of it in God's perspective. I'm giving you this opportunity, you're saying no, I'm going to use someone else. right? But Rebecca realized this, and she said yes. And she became part of God's eternal plan. And look at 61 to 66. And just read this and to make you kilig a little bit. And Rebecca arose and her damsels, and they rode upon the camels and followed the man. And the servant took Rebecca and went his way. And Isaac came from the way of the well, for he dwelt in the south country. And Isaac went out to meditate in the field at eventide, and he lifted up his eyes and saw, and behold, the camels were coming. Ayun ang asawa niya. And Rebecca lifted up her eyes, and when she saw Isaac, she lighted up the camel. And she asked the servant, "What man is this that walketh in the field to meet us?" Sino yan? Siguro, guwapo rin to. Sino yan? Sabi niya. And the servant said, "It is my master. That is the guy you're going to marry." And immediately, she covered herself. And the servant told Isaac all the things he had done. But wait a minute. Just go with, let's look at Isaac a little bit. He's equally obedient to the will of God. Last, 2 days ago, I was chatting with a friend of mine in Phnom Penh. He's my classmate in college. So I asked him, "Are you married now?" Because I'm married. Some of our friends are married. "Are you married now?" He said, "No, I don't have time for it." He said, "I just trust my parents to look for a girl for me, because they know what's best for me." What kind of faith he has with his parents? Who among us here can say that? Ayoko na maghanap. Hayaan ko na lang si Mami. Alam naman niya kung sinong maganda sa akin. Who can do that? I don't want to look for my partner. I'll trust my parents with that. It's ridiculous now, but during the Bible times, it's like that. They trust the authority in their lives to know what's best for them, choose a wife for them, and accept that. Without knowing Rebecca, you see here, he accepted his fate. I'm going to marry Rebecca. And that is what faith really is. Do you know, I'm not saying na wag ka naman ligaw. I'm not prescribing that to any of you here. I'm just trying to make sure that we see the point. Isaac was equally obedient to the will of God. Why? Because the servant told him everything that had happened. And he saw as well, yes, unmistakably, this is the will of God. Even though I don't know this girl who's covering her face, I'm going to marry her. Who knows? Baka pagtanggal, ang pangit pala. Who knows? Baka pag honeymoon na lang, baho pala. But anyway, he obeyed anyway. What kind of faith these people have? Now, sometimes we focus on the mistakes of these people in the Old Testament, right? The way they disobey in some way. But we don't appreciate enough their faith in God. They don't have the Bible. They don't have the Bible. All they have are circumstances and things that their parents are telling them, and stories about the God, the Almighty God, but they have enough faith to follow anyway. We can have this faith because we have the Bible. We can read it. That is the blessing. But for them, they don't have this. All they have is, all Isaac had is the story of the servant, but he trusted that it's true. I'm going to marry Rebecca. Do you have that kind of faith? Now, what is the challenge I want to give you today? And Isaac, let's read the last verse. And Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent and took Rebecca, and she became his wife, and he loved her. And Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. You follow the story, it's a great love story. It's a great story of faith of people. Abraham, the servant, Rebecca, and Isaac. All of these have one thing in common. They are willing to obey the Lord. I don't know what the Lord is impressing in your heart as we study this chapter. I don't know what God has in store for your life, but I do know that God is telling you to do something. Why not say yes to God today? Why not say, "Lord, I'm going to do it. Lord, I want to know what's in store." You don't know what you're missing if you keep on saying no to the Lord. You don't know what you're missing. You don't know that God can bless you. Right? If the Lord is challenging you to be full-time in the ministry, say yes to God. What will happen if I stop doing this? What will happen to me? What will happen to family? Let the Lord worry about that. All you have to be concerned about is, I will obey. Even if the Lord will bless or not, I will obey. Because that is the will of God in my life. Do not keep on saying no. Step out in faith. Obey and see what God in store for you. And God will be able to bless, and you will see the blessing of God in obedience. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning as we conclude our...